Yeah, all right. I think that's the first time I got a response. Woo! All right, I'm energized now. I'm Chris Drescher. My pronouns are he, him, his, and I'm a member of the UUCA Board of Trustees. There's a lot going on here at UUCA, a little bit of update about that in a minute. But there's a lot of places. All right. Too much. Too much. There's so much going on, it's hard to hear. Yeah. That's all right. That's what happens when there's people somewhere. All right. Everybody okay? All right.
Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. We're very formal here. All right. So there's a lot going on, and if you want to find that information, you can find it in your order of service today, but also our weekly e-announcements, newsletters, Instagram, Facebook, website, the Common Area TV, and the bulletin boards. And if you're new, you may also fill out and return a blue card in the seat pocket near you to be added to our email list and Realm, which is the online extension of our community. Some specific things happening coming up for UUCA. On February 7th, Wednesday at 6 p.m., the Navigators USA meeting will be here. If you're not familiar with that, it's an alternative scouting program. And at 7 p.m. this Wednesday, February 7th, in the Sanctuary, the Ecstatic Dance Group will be meeting. On Thursday, February 8th at 6:30, the UU Goddess Group will be meeting in the Common Room. Also, just a reminder, due to carpet staining, no drinks are allowed in the sanctuary except bottled water. But there'll be coffee and refreshments afterwards, and we do hope that you will linger around either on Zoom or in the Common Room for some fellowship. I also want to announce that some of you were able to attend the trunk sale yesterday, organized by the Stewardship Committee here at UUCA. We raised $225 in a couple of hours. And many of our houses are a little less cluttered now. So if you didn't get a chance to come, I have a feeling this will be something that we do again. So stay tuned for that. And worship will begin shortly at 11 a.m. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome on this chilly morning to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Augusta, where we return once again to act with compassion, reason, and respect as we build and create beloved community over and over again. And also where we are very grateful for the talents of our tech deck and also that guy, Josef Patchen. Who, along with the choir, will be adding some beauty to our service this morning. Beauty to the service that we do together here on the lands of the Weso people, the Savannah Shawnees, and the Yuchi peoples of the Muskogee Confederacy. I know that Chris mentioned earlier that there are some cool things coming up. I just want to make clear that the ecstatic dance is open to everyone here. It's just a really important and invigorating spiritual practice for several folks. I know that the Maurers are very much into it. So I also want to note about Josef that he will be leading our next jazz concert at the end of March. Tickets are already on sale.
As we prepare to fully enter into this time of worship, would you please respond with the italicized portion as I read the non-italicized portion of our church covenant? We covenant
to serve our mission
among and beyond us, love and affirm each other and our planet,
celebrating multicultural interdependent wholeness,
live with dignity,
embodying our values through practice and play,
expand our awareness of power and privilege,
centering those most burdened by injustice,
embrace mutual accountability for our impact,
making amends and returning to love,
seek truth and understanding,
exploring with curiosity, reason, and wonder,
support each other's spiritual development,
encouraging faith and transformation.
May this living, relational, and sacred promise offer meaning, liberation, and joy. May we create beloved community.
Our chalice lighting words this morning are by Reverend Dr. David Breeden. Welcome to this place where equity and justice transcend mere dreams, where they are the air we breathe. Enter this sanctuary, all who yearn for respite from a world rife with scarcity and inequity, rife with the relentless shackles of privilege and bias. Come embrace this space, be embraced by this place, this refuge where scarcity and disparity dissolve into we, together, crafting a place where the breath of life is equity and justice, cherished, manifested, and sustained.
Would you rise in body or spirit for our opening hymn number 170, We Are a Gentle, Angry People.
Jan Parsons representing the pastoral care team, and this is the time in our service where we share those joys and sorrows that have come into our lives over this last week.
In a moment, I'm going to read some words from the book After the Good News by Reverend Nancy McDonald Ladd. And as I read those words, I invite you to close your eyes if you'd like, be comfortable in your seats, and listen with your open heart and open mind. And if there are any words or phrases that connect with you on a deeper level, we'll have a moment of silence afterwards for you to reflect on the meaning of that is in your life. If God's name is love, then God compels us to resist the fall to violence by pushing back with muscular resolve against the social structures that confine our capacity to care. A universalist God for a tragic era is not a gauzy, hymn-singing force of personal devotion that draws us endlessly toward itself, but a fierce and compelling power that grips us by the collar amid our rebellious descent and calls us to choose the will to mutuality all over again, even when that choice is so risky that it could utterly remake us. Blessed be and amen.
We come to this church to create a love of community, to work together for justice and equality and equity. So we need financial support to continue with this work, to continue to keep this church alive and going. And I'm asking for your donations to, as you are willing and able to give. And will the ushers please come up?
Thank you.
thank you for your generosity.
Before merging in 1961, Unitarians and Universalists were historically Christian denominations, grounded in a faith tradition named after a prophet from 2,000 years ago-ish. A prophet who gave everything to tear down unjust social systems, systems which magnified inequities of power and privilege and wealth. He pushed back against empire, specifically the Roman Empire. Because of his abiding love for humanity, he began a movement intended to give everyone access to the fullest fruits of life. Fast forward through a couple millennia, and that movement splintered into just a few different versions, perhaps 40,000-ish. And that includes Unitarians and Universalists before we merged. Now, to differentiate from other branches of Christianity, Unitarian basically meant belief in a single God. Jesus was fully human, not one third of God. Though not a God, Unitarians were nonetheless Christian. Jesus and his story of love were still of paramount importance. And through this theology and his example of humanity at its best, Jesus offered considerable agency, potential, and inspiration for all humans to continuously settle into our most natural condition. That is, guided by our conscience, defined by love. Love of God, love of each other, and to move the world toward love and break down every barrier to that unified progress. In short, justice. Universalist basically meant belief that everybody, in the end, would find salvation in heaven. Everybody was loved by God, regardless of station, sin, skill, intellect. We'd all end up in the same space of grace. Because of this, not despite it, many Universalists, if not most, believed we should at least make the attempt to help every human being flourish here on Earth. Everybody should have access to the same result on Earth. In short, equity. That was the short version. Now for the slightly more long-winded bit. Though the theology has existed since the dawn of Christianity, Unitarian Christianity wasn't fully claimed as a religious identity until 1819, when Reverend William Ellery Channing gave his Baltimore sermon at an ordination for Jared Sparks in, you guessed it, Baltimore. Before then, Unitarian was used as an insult for liberal Congregationalists in New England. And he just stole that and just subverted it and made it his own. But in addition to subverting that unjust game, by audaciously claiming the title Unitarian, Channing attempted to free religion from exclusive reliance upon church doctrine. Free religion from literal readings of the Christian Bible. Free religion from prescribed understandings which propped up inequities of power and privilege and wealth. In doing so, he established human reason as valid and necessary for the interpretation of Scripture, not as the only basis for religious belief, but as an aid to revelation, for reading and understanding the meaning of the Bible. He said, quote, "Our leading principle in interpreting Scripture is this, that the Bible is a book written for men in the language of men, and that its meaning is to be sought in the same manner as that of other books. With these views of the Bible, we feel it our bounden duty to exercise our reason upon it perpetually, to compare, to infer, to look beyond the letter to the spirit," end quote. I'll come back to the four men of men bit in a moment. But with this prophetic sermon, Channing began to release all biblical barriers between humans and revelation. Though reason was the first step, he began to release any barrier to revelation, any barrier to seeing the full game without any fence blocking our view. Acknowledging, even celebrating human agency, he changed the sacred system and made it more just, more relational between the humans and the divine, humans and good, humans and justice. And FYI, the word justice was mentioned 22 times in the Baltimore sermon, usually referring to humans' highest aspiration in the true nature of God. Speaking of relationship between God and humanity, that's what early Universalist leaders James Relly, John Murray, and Judith Sargent Murray based their entire theology upon. In her Records of the Life of the Reverend John Murray from 1816, Judith Sargent Murray said, quote, "The sacred scriptures abound with figures of this mysterious, this ennobling, this soul-satisfying union, among which, perhaps, none is more than that of the head and members constituting one body. Should a single member of this mystical body be finally lost, the Redeemer must, through eternity, remain imperfect," end quote. In other words, all of humanity is harmed forever without relational equity for everyone. In 1841, another important early Unitarian prophet, Reverend Theodore Parker, who was also a leading abolitionist and transcendentalist, preached a controversial sermon, "The Transient and the Permanent in Christianity." UU historian Eugene Navias summarizes the sermon as thus, quote, "Parker considered the transient elements of Christianity to be miracles, revelations, creeds, and doctrines, and the permanent elements to be in the moral sense within the hearts of good persons. Any truths which are in the teachings of Jesus are there because they meet the practical tests of life, not because of the outward authority of Jesus, the Bible, the church, or creeds," end quote. So with this sermon, Unitarian Christianity was bumped further toward an equitable distribution of sources. Barriers to religious experience and understanding were once again torn down. And Parker makes it very clear. A real and lived morality is the permanent element of religious truths, Christianity in his case. And for him, morality and justice, for which Parker fiercely fought his whole life, are synonymous. Here are just a few of his notable quotes on the divine connection between morality and justice.
"Justice is the constitution or fundamental law of the moral universe, the law of right, a rule of conduct for man in all his moral relations.
Justice is a moral temperance in the world of man. It keeps just relations between men. I am to do justice and demand it of all. A universal human debt, a universal human claim.
I love justice, not for its consequences for body or gain, but for itself, for the moral truth.
Man naturally loves justice for its own sake, as the natural object of his conscience. As the mind loves truth and beauty, so conscience loves the right. It is true and beautiful to the moral faculties. Conscience rests in justice as an end, as the mind in truth. As truth is the side of God turned toward the intellect, so is justice the side of him which conscience looks upon. Love of justice is the moral part of piety."
And his most famous quote you may have heard before by way of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., you know, something about the arc of the moral universe bending toward justice. Now, I mentioned I would return to the foreman of men bit from Channing's Baltimore sermon. At his time, it was exclusively men who were given ministerial authority. And yet, it was Unitarians and Universalists who broke the glass ceiling, who broke down the barrier to inclusion based on gender, and first ordained women. The very first woman ordained in the United States given full denominational authority was Universalist Reverend Olympia Brown in 1863. Now, though there were several important male allies who championed their cause, the denominations at large were initially hesitant and not immediately supportive of their ministries. Yet the resilient agency and love of justice by women leaders broke through nonetheless. The Iowa Sisterhood of Unitarian Ministers is an important moment in that progress. The Iowa Sisterhood consisted of 21 women ministers who founded and served churches throughout the Midwest in the late 1800s. Men were less willing to do the hard work of rural church planting. And that's true, like they just didn't want to, so. Now, these women did so much to revamp the patriarchal mold of ministry. They made it more pastoral, less hierarchical. They made ministry a week-long effort, not just on Sundays. They made the religious experience more just. One of the Iowa sisters was Reverend Mary Safford, who wrote the hymn Great Over Soul and Enter Heart in 1895, a hymn which makes clear the importance of love and freedom for all. And three verses of that hymn go like this. This church we love, to thee we bring, and while our spirits intimately sing, we pray that it may ever be a home for all who seek for thee, the home of faith in all things true, a faith that seeks the larger view, the home of love that yearns to bless, the home of truth and righteousness. Long may it stand the outward sign of that indwelling life divine, which makes thy children truly free and draws them ever nearer thee. Which makes thy children truly free, she said. Freedom, justice for all is once again the baseline goal in our home of faith. By the way, women now make up a majority of UU clergy, and it's not even close. There's so much more I could share about how Universalists and Unitarians, and subsequently Unitarian Universalists, built our religions upon the pillars of justice and equity. Weaved throughout every variation of our theologies as they and we have transformed over time, perpetually promoting these fundamental values through word and, more importantly, deed, even as we made and make a ton of mistakes along the way. And we'll dive into more of those stories during faith formation following the service. And the adults will be meeting here in the sanctuary. We'll specifically look at stories about Unitarian Universalists who were involved in a whole lot of justice and equity efforts in the 20th century. Stories through which I'm excited to make more meaning with you all starting at 12:15. Kids will go with their facilitators in the back hallway. So modern Unitarian Universalist minister David Battee writes, "The work of justice making is never an individual passion. I've discovered that if our commitments are only on an individual basis and we fail to engage our religious communities in this work, we are unlikely to change the realities of systematic racism and other oppressions. I believe it is only through the communal work of building the beloved community that we will find liberation," end quote. The work of liberation is first and foremost rooted in the lives of those who have experienced oppression, and yet also in the lives of those who serve as their allies. In our history, as Unitarian Universalists, we have had many who fell into one or both of those categories, oppressed and or ally. The hope of mutual benefit and flourishing is at the heart of all their good faith efforts. Every one of us, every human, needs allies at times, and every one of us can choose to be an ally for someone else, to choose to be in solidarity with those who suffer the most. Inequity and justice have long been complementary values, allies, one might say, which point to the same conclusion. They're both collective efforts long embodied by Unitarians, Universalists, and Unitarian Universalists. Just like us, these values support each other when efforts fail. They hold each other up. And the moral drive at the heart of each keeps the train moving. Loyalty to each other and the spirit of life, love, and justice keeps the steam pumping. When combined through human effort, equity and justice lead toward liberation, flourishing, a sense of wholeness for every body on earth, as it doesn't really matter in heaven. May we remain resolute in our embodiment of these essential UU values, these pillars of good faith. Side by side, may we, all of us, may we reinforce goodness and love as pillars of good faith ourselves. May we create beloved community. In a moment, we'll sing together hymn number 1030, I believe. 1020. And the words will be up on the screen. At the end, we'll sing the word wo ya ya over and over again, back and forth, call and response. Just getting into the groove of it, letting the perpetual motion of it help us feel the perpetual motion that we carry ourselves. Closing words today come from her brand new book, Black Liturgies, by Cole Arthur Riley, who says, justice alone is not the destination. Becoming human is. This is liberation. We want no use for gavels, no need for sit-ins or philanthropy, no need for food drives or keys clenched between knuckles at night. We want more. But until then, we speak, we organize, we create, we hold hope for one another on the edge of despair, our voices sustained in the collective. Whether they listen or fail to listen, our mouth is ours, and there is meaning in that. Blessed be.
Thank you.